Welcome to the 4th Congressional District Candidates Forum. My name is Marguerite Reinberger. This forum is sponsored by the Stillwater Gazette. There are three candidates vying for this position, and they are, in alphabetical order, Independence Party endorsed Steve Carlson, Republican endorsed candidate Tony Hernandez, and DFL endorsed candidate Betty McCollum. Thank you for coming. Thank all of you for coming on such a gloomy evening. This is great. Each candidate will be allowed a 1.5 minute opening and a 2 minute closing statement. You'll have up to 2 minutes to respond to my questions. At my discretion only, I'll allow for 1 minute rebuttals during the question time only. Forum organizer Beth Johnson will be the timekeeper. She'll hold up 45 second, 15 second in stop cards. When you see the stop card, complete the one sentence that you're in. The Stillwater Gazette has provided the questions that will be asked, and I want those who are watching and those in attendance to please go up to the candidates after or contact them if there are any questions that were not addressed during this forum. And last of all, please save your applause and your disapproval and approval of the candidates. Well, for the polls, it would be really helpful so we can ask more questions. Let's begin with opening statements for 1.5 minutes, Betty McCollum.
Thank you. Thank you for coming out to this debate. This is a very exciting time. We're just 2 weeks away from the election. And you came here to hear from us about our visions for the families of the 4th District. A little bit about me. I grew up and raised my children in the 4th District. In fact, my kids went to North Central High School, and my son was on the swim team, so I used to get up very early in the morning to drive over to the pool here so he could have swim time. And just what a wonderful community Stillwater is in the 4th District. We've got a choice in this election. And this choice can be about going forward and investing in our families and working our way out of this difficult decision on how to balance our deficit and balance our families' needs. Or we can continue with the same failed policies of the past. So I'm here today to answer your questions and to talk about how I believe that we can move our families forward and create a stronger economy for the East Metro.
Thank you, Tony.
My fellow citizens, welcome to the new 4th Congressional District, and thank you for attending this debate tonight. I'd like to thank the Stillwater Gazette, ECM Editorial Board, Marguerite for moderating this debate, and my opponents. My name is Tony Hernandez, and I'd be honored to serve you, the people, and the families in the United States House of Representatives. I'm asking to turn your vote, and I'm asking you to send me to Congress, where I will work diligently with Democrats and Republicans to solve the great problems of our day. Namely, I'll work with others on policies that will create jobs, reduce the national debt, honor our commitments to our seniors and our U.S. veterans, and finally, rebuild the American dream for our future generations. I'm not a career politician. My professional background is in finance and in teaching, and I decided that I wanted to run for office in 2008, and it was Representative McCollum's vote for the Wall Street bailouts that really ignited my political passions, and it's the reason that I'm here with you today. Now, Representative McCollum is going to sit and she's going to try to make the argument that if you vote for me, that somehow I'm going to lead the country backwards. Nothing could be further from the truth. The fact is, the incumbent is supporting the same old policies that are failing Minnesota families on jobs and the economy. She wants to extend the Bush tax cuts. I want tax reform now. She wants to extend the war in Afghanistan. I want to end the war and bring our troops home now.
Stop.
Finally, I'm asking to turn your vote, and it's an honor to be here. Thank you.
I'm going to ask that you guys honor the timekeeper. Steve, thank you. Steve.
Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for being here and for inviting me and for debating. A neighbor remarked that we have had now more debates than Mitt Romney and Barack Obama, President Obama. That is because the 4th Congressional District is changing, and America is changing. Now, on November 6th, you have an opportunity to set a reasonable and experienced leader, Steve Carlson, into the gridlock. I will solve that gridlock. I understand both parties. I've also learned that you don't always get a chance to address every question, so I want to just address two quick questions here that are actually federal issues. The voter ID and the marriage amendment, where I stand. Marriage is a federal issue because this is the First Amendment vote to be overshadowed by a president who had decided not to defend DOMA and to politicize Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And voter ID also started in the Florida elections and is a federal issue. And what we're trying to do is to use our paper-based ballot and try to improve it so that we can have shorter lines, quicker voting, and a much more effective system. And I thought that was the stop, but I have more to say. Now, let me just get into the voter ID a little bit. Betty always says, well, I'm fighting for voting rights, but in reality, there's some suppression going on, which I'll talk to you about.
Not now, you won't.
What's the same sentence?
I was worried it could go much longer. Okay, thank you. And I'll begin the next question with Betty. Betty will also end with the closing, but the first question will go with the first person. And question is, we've had 4 years of trillion-dollar deficits. What substantial cuts, if any, do you suggest we make to get this more under control? In other words, at what point is enough enough?
Well, we have to do something about our debt and deficits. We absolutely have to. But we need to have a balanced approach. You know, Simpson-Bowles and economists, both conservative and Republican, have and liberal and democratic economists and independent economists all say that we need to put everything on the table. And that means we need to look at tax cuts, we need to look at spending, we need to look at closing loopholes, and we need to look at doing some retirement reform. If we don't have everything on the table, we can't make our economy grow in a way in which we can compete in the 21st century. So one of the things that I think that we should do is we should repeal the upper level tax cuts for that President Bush put in, and we should do that, and we should leave the middle class tax cuts in place, because the economists say right now the middle class is struggling, and we need to make sure that we provide opportunities for middle class families to continue weathering the storm. But we do see improvement in the economy. Here in Minnesota, we have our unemployment rate is much lower. I just met with a group of realtors. They're starting to see an uptick in housing, but our economy is fragile, so we need to do the things to make it stronger. So I'm for a balanced approach, and I also, when I get to Congress, I would like to reinstate pay-as-you-go budgeting. When the Democrats were in charge, for the 2 short years that we were in the majority, we were trying to bring an end to this debt deficit, and we were paying for projects in a timely fashion. In other words, we were working towards balance. The Republicans repealed that. I would put that back in place.
Thank you, Tony.
For the record, Representative McCollum did not offer one area of cuts, which is what the actual question was about. I, too, am in favor of a balanced approach to reducing the deficit and reducing the debt. That means we need to increase revenues and also look at ways that will responsibly reduce spending without affecting our seniors or our poor. First of all, as I stated in my opening remarks, I believe we need to end the war in Afghanistan now. That'll give us immediate savings. It'll allow us to reduce the deficit in a timely manner. Secondly, we need to fix our economy and balance the size of the spending and of the federal government in order to match the private sector. The more Minnesotans that we can get working, the more Minnesotans there are paying taxes and therefore increasing revenues to the federal government. So I disagree with Representative McCollum. She's not in favor of a balanced approach. Her only solution, and I don't even agree that it is a solution, is to tax the rich. I believe that that's a political solution, but in terms of actually reducing the deficit, it's a drop in the bucket in terms of the amount of money that we're overspending every year and the amount of money that we're borrowing on an annual basis. When Representative McCollum was sworn into Congress in 2001, the national debt was $5.7 trillion. We just exceeded $16 trillion. It's almost triple from 12 years ago when you were sworn into office. So we need leaders and representatives that are committed to making the tough decisions that is going to ultimately balance our budget and get our economy back on track.
Looks like I'm starting my rebuttal time earlier than usual. Would you like to respond?
Well, yes. I voted against many of the things that that led to this this debt and deficit problem we're having. I voted against the Iraq War. I voted against the upper-level Bush tax cuts. I voted against Medicare Part D, not because seniors didn't deserve to have prescription drug benefits, but because it did not balance. I didn't vote for those things, but you know what? That's the reality of the world we live in. So I have a responsibility to show up to work and try to solve the problems. As far as the upper-level Bush tax cuts, look, if everybody gets middle-class tax cuts, so does the upper 2%. But why in heaven's name would we borrow almost $690 billion from China to pay for extra tax cuts for people who are doing just fine in this economy? I won't do that because the middle class gets stuck with the bill paying the interest. So when it's all said and done and you add up to the interest for the upper level of 1% tax cuts, is $830 billion, and I won't stick that to the middle class.
Hey, hang on. I'm going to go to Steve now.
Thank you. Well, first of all, enough is enough. It's clear. We cannot continue to have the federal spending go up. I think everybody in the country now knows that. And we are facing a fiscal cliff, even before the new Congress and the new president take office. And so I've always been interested to know whether Betty is actually going to back the Budget Control Act, the sequestration. She said she voted against it, but I haven't heard any other ideas. A balanced budget or a balanced approach. A balanced budget would do it, but a balanced approach is not a balanced budget. It wouldn't do it. Now, I think, and I'll tell you why. But first of all, I want to say that to drive a war just to save money, I can't agree with that. I think we can't cut our military. I think we need to maintain a strong national defense. And I don't think that should be dictated by our bookkeeping here at home. I don't think that Betty's voting against all these things really holds much water, because that's really not what created this deficit. What created it was the debacle of 2008, which was a very bad idea in home ownership, which was mortgage-backed securities, which were bad investments, which the Federal Reserve is still buying those up with QE3. So I think that's still a very dangerous situation. So what we need to do is look at the whole situation. We need to understand the economy, the role of the private sector. Now let me tell you, I mentioned why the raising taxes or cutting the taxes, well let's put it this way, cutting taxes on middle class and raising taxes on the rich isn't going to do much. This so-called balanced approach will do nothing but kill jobs, kill businesses, and will increase spending. We've got two parties out there that are very willing to spend $3 to $4 trillion a year. I think everybody knows that. And so what we need to do is to send the power and the resources back to the state of Minnesota, because Minnesota can do it better. We can all go over to the Capitol and we can decide what to do rather than waiting for Washington to tell us what we should do. Now what this is gonna do, it's, as Mitt Romney has pointed out, is gonna reduce, just by shifting the same programs to the state level, you're going to save $100 billion a year just in interest, because we have to balance the budget. Whereas all that money is going to be borrowed from China, not just the rich tax cuts money, but all of it, including the middle class.
Thank you. Would you like a minute to respond?
You were brought up. I think Mr. Hernandez has some ideas.
A minute.
Well, still, we didn't hear anything from Representative McCollum in terms of tangible reductions.
Wait, I said to respond to Steve.
What am I supposed to respond to?
Yeah, no, you weren't supposed to respond to anything. She offered you a response time. Would you like to respond? You mentioned you in there, in your votes.
Sure. I mean, I've got a whole packet full of cuts here. And I've been working across the aisle with a lot of my fellow Congress men and women. So this is Taxpayers for Common Sense. There's a lot of great ideas in Simpson-Bowles, but I know we need to look at cutting defense spending. We also need to look at cutting other agencies where programs aren't working and aren't delivering services. We should cut them, but we need to do it in a smart way that doesn't lead us to not being able to invest in our children's education and our infrastructure here at home.
Thank you. I'm going on to the next question. Tony, I'll begin with you.
Okay.
Some predict that by the year 2017, China will surpass us in gross national product, a title we have held since Ulysses Grant was president in the 1870s. What, if anything, do you suggest we do to prevent that?
We got to look at our trade imbalance. Right now, you know, I spend a lot of time with my grandfather. He talks about the America in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s. When you were buying products back then, you'd flip over the clothes or the article or whatever it was, and you would see made in America. And now, over the last 20 to 30 years, we've seen an enormous trade balance where nearly everything that you and I buy, probably including my suit and this tie that I just purchased today from Herberger's on a 50% discount, is made in China. And we need to look at ways in order to reduce that trade imbalance. Now, there's a lot of talk about China cheating on their currency. They're manipulating their currency in order to make it lower compared to ours, making their goods less expensive and making their labor less expensive. And there's talk about if we label China, as Mitt Romney has suggested, a currency manipulator, that we could instigate some type of a trade war. Well, if you just look at the numbers, China is still to this day much more dependent on you and I and all of us in this room and watching the show buying their goods. And so if a trade war is a possibility at this time, my answer is that we would win that trade war indefinitely. So we need to really bring smart people to the table, business-oriented minds to do negotiations with China, to renegotiate some of the agreements that we have in order to offset the trade balance and leveling the playing field. So once again, that American businesses are able to compete with China on a global level in terms of cost of production, cost of manufacturing, and then ultimately the cost of labor. So we need to look at the trade agreements. We need to look at the ways that these are negotiated. My feeling is, and I don't have so much knowledge in the area, but we're sending people to negotiate that are career politicians rather than business-minded American individuals. And I think if we can change some of that, we'll offset the trade balance and really bring the good manufacturing jobs back to our shores.
Thank you. Steve.
Well, first of all, I think that the question assumes there's only one China. And I was the managing editor at the Asian American Press for about 7 years. And I had the opportunity to interview people like the ambassador from China, people from the ASEAN, their consulates, and met people from the World Trade Center. One time I got to talk to a person who I believe was from Singapore, and I asked him about the issues of the economy and also human rights. And what he told me is that all the Chinas are going to rise together. Now, what does that mean? It means you've got Hong Kong, you've got Taiwan, you've got Singapore, you've got China. These are the overseas Chinese. So if you think that you're just competing with one country called China, I think you're wrong. And so we need to look at, here's a surprising recommendation I would have, and that would be the auto industry, privatize it. Privatize it as fast as you can so it can survive and it can use the power of our private investment so that people are going to get a return. Get it away from the government, because I hear all of this talk about how, what, you know, all these jobs were saved and created in the auto industry and Romney would have taken it into bankruptcy. That's not true, because that is, who is the strongest GM in the world? Probably China. The way the administration says they're selling more cars to China. No, they're making more cars in China. You know, when we went, we're going bankrupt. Canada, GM wasn't going bankrupt. Mexico, Brazil, they weren't going bankrupt. So we need to we got to have real leadership in this industry. Also the computer industry, it's all in China. So I think really just going back to developing our liberties, encouraging people to study hard. I'll tell you about these Chinese. They study hard. The Vietnamese study hard. The Japanese study hard. We haven't even mentioned them. And I think Japan is going to be right up there. I think they're probably number three right now. They were just passed by China as far as you're talking about consumer spending.
Thank you. Yep.
Well, this is where we have to make smart decisions in bringing down our debt and deficit. This is where we have to make sure that we don't cut what can create opportunities and innovation for our manufacturing and for people here at home. We need to be investing in the new wave of technology. Anywhere you go in the 4th District, there are all kinds of incubators and labs, and as whether it's MedTech or whether it's wind, there's a lot of wind companies here that are trying to figure out a way to harness the wind and move towards clean energy. I was just at an opening at Ramsey County Detention Center where the solar panels were made right here in Minnesota. There are so many opportunities working with our universities, working with entrepreneurs, working with engineers, working with the creative minds that are here. But that also means we have to make sure that we're investing in our children and in our workforce, giving them the tools that they need to compete. The new wave of manufacturing can either happen here in the United States because we make smart choices and smart investments in infrastructure to allow high speed and supercomputing, and that so we can do the models and so that we can do the new engineering here. But there's also infrastructure that needs to be replaced and repaired here, our roads and our bridges that put people back to work and also allows the movement of goods and transportation across this country. So there's a lot of opportunity out here, and business is just waiting for Congress to get to work to find a balanced approach to bring our economy in order so that they can have the confidence to start investing in their employees and expansion.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Steve. Are there positions on issues where you disagree with your party? What are they, and why do you disagree?
Well, the party that I'm with is called the Independence Party. Notice that little word, independence. And what it means is that you should think independently and you should not think along the party line. I frankly wonder, what are we talking about parties taking positions? What we're trying to do is get fresh, innovative thinking, insightful, compassionate thinking. Now, as far, I understand they had a meeting and Jim Graves has been in the paper. I suppose he kind of bought the party because he got together with them and he asked them, can you take these positions on the marriage amendment, for instance? I think that was the big one. And so do I disagree with Jim Graves or do I disagree with people who really identify with the Independence Party? Now I know that Jesse Ventura, he's got a big heart and he thinks love is bigger than the government. And I'm sure that's true, but I don't think that's the issue. I think that marriage is, you know, it's tried and true and tested, and it needs all the help that it can get. If it is to me a miracle, it's a miracle when two people come together and are able to begin an estate, begin a family that can pass on from generation to generation and build an environment where people can be nurtured and can contribute to the country. And how many people have succeeded? You know, how many people, when they get their 50th anniversary, do you really respect them and really thank, and all the hardships they've been through just to stay together and just to make that family go? I don't want to throw that out, but I did support the founding of the Human Rights Party when I was at the University of Minnesota. A gentleman pointed out to me that in St. Paul they were going to pass an ordinance which would take human rights away from, we're talking about housing, we're talking about employment, based on your sexual preference. And the whole party was aimed to stop that, but it was not aimed to overthrow marriage, to overthrow the military. Basically, I think we're getting into a situation where, in fact, I can tell you, I was at a meeting where Alan Spear first said that we're going to talk about marriage. And I said right away, well, that wouldn't be really marriage, but I can understand why they want to do that. They want to protect their lifestyle.
Thank you, Jim Graves, wherever you are. I have rebuttal time waiting for you. Yeah. Do you want me to repeat the question, or do you remember it?
It was about, what are some things?
Yeah, what are there positions on issues where you disagree with your party? What are they and why do you disagree?
Well, for the majority of time in the 12 years I've had the honor and privilege of serving the constituents of the 4th District, I've been in the minority. So it's pretty much been, you know, fighting back, and I mentioned some of the things that I voted against, including your RAW4. But there is something that I did not think should be in the Affordable Care Act of Obamacare. Because Obama does care. So I'm happy to call it that. And that was a medical device tax. It wasn't in the original House bill. The Senate put it in. I led a rebellion in the House. We got it cut in half, and we're still working to get it removed. And I think that that was a huge mistake that my party made, and something that I worked to repeal.
Thank you, Tony.
Sure. There's many areas where I disagree from the Republican National Party. I would have voted the same way that Representative McCollum did in terms of the authorization of force against Iraq. I'd like to say about the medical device tax, just briefly, you know, we brought this up and we've debated it, and at the end of the day, you voted for it, which means you supported it, and now yourself and Senator Amy Klobuchar are leading a movement to try to repeal it, and President Obama has vowed to veto it if that comes across his desk. So I think we need people that are taking responsibility for their votes, and in this case, you're not taking responsibility. You voted for the Affordable Care Act, which included the medical device tax. So I think you need to take credit for that. I disagreed with President Bush and Representative McCollum when they joined forces in 2008 to bail out the Wall Street banks. I don't believe in too big to fail. I still don't believe in too big to fail, and I believe that our economy and job growth is suffering as a result of using this borrowed money to bail out the same institutions that led us into this mess. A lot of Republicans disagree with my balanced approach that we need in order to reduce the deficit. I'm a proud member of the middle class, and many of you can probably attest, if your family or your household is spending more than what you're taking in every month or every year, you need to take a balanced approach. You need to find ways to responsibly reduce your spending, and you also may need to take an extra job, a part-time job, or your spouse may need to work in order to increase the revenues that are coming in to your particular household. I have not signed on to the Ryan budget in particular. I've spent many, many a days in senior homes in our district. I've discussed the issue of Medicare and Social Security with our seniors, and I've determined that the best course of action for Medicare and Social Security is to strengthen our programs rather than trying to change the entire program. And so really, I'm in favor of an idea called means testing, you know, where we're adjusting the benefits given the particular seniors' income and asset levels and making the adjustments accordingly. I don't believe we need to take away any benefits from our seniors. I realize that they've paid in their entire lives for this. I am in favor of strengthening Medicare and Social Security so that this great program is maintained for our seniors and also for future generations.
Thank you, Ben. Would you like to respond now?
Well, you know, when you go to Washington, you're not gonna get everything you want. And on balance, I looked at the Affordable Care Act and I went, is it good to for families not to be able to have a child not being covered because they have a pre-existing condition? Yeah, I wanted to do something about pre-existing conditions. Did I want to do something to make remove the donut-hole for seniors? Absolutely. Did I want to make sure that a person going through chemotherapy and a family found out that they were capped off with their insurance? I looked at the totality of the Affordable Care Act, and I'm proud of my vote for it. And so you have my pledge that I'm going to fight hard, but I'm also going to work hard to find common ground and to compromise. And when I don't get my way all the time, doesn't mean I'm going to stop working to move America forward. So the depression that we almost looked into, I voted with Speaker Boehner. I voted with Paul Ryan to keep our country slipping into a depression, the worst recession in 70 years.
I'm going on to the next question. Betty, it's no secret that there's a deep bipartisan divide in Congress. What do you think can be done to bring more cooperation and compromise in Congress? Can this even be achieved?
Well, as I said earlier, it's about knowing that if you don't get 100% of what you want, if you get 80% of what you think is good for your district, you're there to work together with other people. And that's part of your job. And you have my pledge to fight hard for the 4th District, but at the end, I'm there to get something done, and then I'll come home and I'll face the voters, just like I'm facing them now, and this is a job interview. And I'm asking for your support and your vote in this job interview. But I do have some fabulous relationships with a couple, I'll mention three gentlemen from the other side of the aisle, Steve Lochtreff from Ohio. We're working on Asian carb issues together, and, you know, that has the potential not only threatening in Mississippi, but I've spoken to people here very concerned about what could happen to St. Croix. Tom Cole, in fact, who was one of the head leaders in the Republican Party for years and still is a key player there. We work on Native American issues all across Indian country together. And Jack Kingston, a very, very conservative gentleman from Georgia, was helping me with cutting wasteful spending. So I put my hand across the aisle. We need all the help we can get. We all need to be on Team America.
Thank you, Tony.
Sure. I just want to go quickly back to the bailouts first. And you know, you mentioned you worked together with Speaker Boehner and Ryan and President Bush. And I just want to go on the record to say that you were all wrong at that time. And there's a lot of times when the two parties come together and they tend to be wrong. In fact, it's been my experience when the two parties come together, oftentimes it's either the bailout, the corporations, or the increase our presence militarily across the world. How are we going to get members of Congress to begin working together? My first suggestion is with your vote. We need new representation, not only in this district, but nationwide. I believe that that is step number one. There are too many members of Congress that have occupied their seat for literally decades. I believe that that is part of the problem. Secondly, and Representative McCollum voted against this, I believe that we need a budget amendment similar to what we have in Minnesota, which requires the legislator every couple of years or every year to produce an operating balanced budget. This requires members of Congress to work together to produce a budget. The federal government has failed to produce a budget for the last 4 years. You talk to businesses and you wonder why there's not business growth and job growth. It's because of the uncertainty that's being created by members of Congress in Washington, D.C. So a budget amendment would be a good thing. Finally, if you go to my website, you'll see that I'm also against all these congressional entitlements. I think we need to end the congressional pension system. I think we need to measure the level of pay for congressmen and women to that of the private sector. I believe congressional members get paid way too much at this point in time. And it would go a long way for members of Congress to stand up and tell the middle class that not only do I stand with you, but I stand side by side with you and not excluding myself from laws or giving myself these enormous entitlements.
Thank you. I promise I'll get to you, Steve, but I'm going to allow Betty time to rebut.
Well, maybe I should be happy to announce that I'm one of the poorest members of Congress here tonight. I think what you bring up about not having a budget, we do have a budget. The budget that passed is the Budget Control Act, which I voted against, which is going to have all these deep across-the-board sequestration cuts, which has no accountability and no responsibility to the families in this room to make sure that we're making smart choices and smart investments. I support pay-as-you-go budgeting, and we've worked really hard to get that in the short period of time when I served with the majority, and that if you were gonna pay for something, you wanted something, you had to pay for it. And quite often that may need trainings and cuts that we make in our budgets. Republicans repeal that. And so I'm not going to apologize for trying to work really hard by voting against some of these horrific pieces of legislation that I mentioned earlier that really put us in debt, and for trying to have a system that was pay as you go.
Thank you. Steve.
Well, we're on a fiscal cliff. I mean, picture two people on a cliff. They have nowhere to go. What are they going to do? Are they going to duke it out? No. But what we're doing, we're going back to these, there's your breaking through the gridlock. Look down, and say, where are we going? Of course, we're going to work together. I'm not very impressed by knowing three Republicans. When I was in the University Senate, I knew people from all parties. Forget about party. Oh, and I would like to point out, if you elect me, it will not add one Republican or one Democrat to the House balance. And so you won't be just fighting it up. Oh, how are we gonna have bipartisan agreement? We're gonna elect more Democrats, or we're gonna elect more Republicans. That's the bad answer, and it's not working. Now, a budget is a good exercise. I think that would be helpful if they started, but that's just an exercise. We're on a fiscal cliff. Look, we've got to make the right decision on this one. Once we make the right decision, everybody's going to breathe easier and they're going to work together. And I'll tell you what's going to happen. When we do start to turn back the federal deficit, we are going to bring back trillions of dollars into this country because people have been holding their collective breath. This is an ideological party, is an ideological president who's making outrageous decisions. Basically, I urge you to look up House Resolution 5808 from the 111th Congress, I believe. It could be 112th. That's the one that signed up 123 Democratic House members, including Benny McCollum, and including Keith Ellison, and including Jim Oberstar. You remember Jim Oberstar, okay? They all signed up for the public option. Even after we passed the Obamacare as it is, they don't want that, they want a placeholder. So what we need to do to work together is to really try to address these fiscal issues that we face, not try to pass grandiose Roosevelt-type schemes and make your mark in history. We're looking at history, folks, and history looks a little scary. Now, on the other hand, as I pointed out, 36% of marginal income tax, and you're going to go up to 39. That's no fiscal cliff.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Tony. Keeping in mind the vast amount of money spent in our missions in Iran and Afghanistan, what justification, if any, do you have for us to continue this expenditure of lives and finances?
None. And did anyone here watch the Vice President's debate with Vice President Biden and Representative Paul Ryan, our Vice President candidate? One area that I took away from this debate is that the threat from Iran is nowhere near as large or as grandiose as the media or some of our warmongering politicians would want to make us think that it is. Do I want a nuclear Iran? No. Do I believe we need to have an absolutely strong military? Yes. I believe that our strength and our security begins at our border between Mexico and the United States and insofar Canada and the United States. Right now, we still have not been able to secure our own border, and I pointed this out in our last debate. I find it ironic that our U.S. military, our brave soldiers, men and women, are able to secure the borders between Iran and Iraq literally within weeks, and we have failed in an enormous level in terms of securing our border between Mexico and the United States. A terrorist would be able to sneak a dirty bomb through those borders still. There's tunnels. There's a whole wide variety of measures that people can come into our country and do us harm. So I believe that peace can be achieved through strength, and strength begins at our borders. And as your congressman, I will be focused like a laser to ensure that our borders are secure and America remains safe.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay, warmongering politicians. I don't really think that we have any warmongering politicians. Now, there are arms dealers. They like war. But I don't think there's any politician that feels good about putting an American in harm's way. Now, I have served in the United States Air Force. I served for 4 years during the tail end of the Vietnam War. I kind of worked in intelligence. I was a Vietnamese linguist. That was my... And I would monitor radio transmissions and actually interrogate in Vietnam. I'm aware of what war looks like and some of the issues at stake here. I'll tell you why we should stay in Iraq. It's true. They tried to, and they should have tried to, get a status of forces agreement. And what you do there is you realize that once you've been involved in a war, you've got to have a plan to get out and what you want to accomplish. Now, we wanted to bring security and peace to the region. We wanted to promote democracy, I think, is to say, you know, our way of life is something you should look at. We should all try to get along together instead of fighting our religious wars, because we've been through all that. We developed this constitution, and this is what you should do, too. And but in order to do that, you need to have some sensibility of what you're leaving behind. You leave behind a wake, like a ship leaving a big wake. It's very unstable. And what does it really look like down in those murky waters? And we need to have a clear vision about this when we go in. Now, my concern is not just the protocol of working with generals on the ground. It's understanding what impact we're having. Look at Egypt, for instance. Who was it that had this idea that we should have this big social media festivity in the streets and everything would turn out real good? Now, there's a lot of Michelle Bachmann voters in this district, and she's done a responsible thing by saying, look, whoever planned this, we don't know why, whether it was infiltration, whether it was not infiltration. How did we end up putting the Muslim Brotherhood in charge? Now, why was the Muslim Brotherhood not allowed? Because their constitution, because two previous presidents had been killed by these people, presidents, openly assassinated, were not allowed to form a religious-based party. Now they're in charge. Now Romney has to go in and he has to say to Egypt, look, you've got to honor our agreement to maintain peace with Israel.
Thank you.
The question was on Iraq and Afghanistan.
Yes. What justification do you have to continue this expenditure of lives and finances?
Well, you know, we're out of Iraq now, and we shouldn't have gone in there in the first place. But I thank all of our soldiers and their families for some of them made the ultimate sacrifice, and many of them are still struggling, you know, with mental health issues, with physical health issues, and we need to do everything we can to support our veterans. Afghanistan, it's time to come home, and we need to bring home our troops home soon and safe. And the reason why I say soon and safe is it's not up to me to set an arbitrary date. It's up to work with our military leadership, with the withdrawal, as we did in Iraq, so that as our troops withdrew, that they were safe and that they were secure, and that we brought back the military hardware and equipment that maybe could have fallen into hands that would have used them against us. So it's time to come home. The Karzai government is corrupt. The international community, which we went into Afghanistan, is leading as well. So it's time to come home. And I thank our soldiers and our service men and women for their service.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Steve. The United States has a chance of becoming the largest oil petrochemical producer in the world within the next few years. What, if anything, would you do to encourage this?
Okay, I do agree that we need to look at all kinds of energy. And I would not only look at the production of energy, but the consumption of energy. And by that, I don't mean just conservation. I'm talking about smart use of energy. Things like hybrid cars, where we reduce our energy consumption and make smart use of economic, efficient, scientific, engineering of energy use. And by the way, that should include the calories that we take in when we eat. We're overweight because we don't really, that's inefficient use of energy. Now, as far as oil itself, I agree with the points made by Mitt Romney that these subsidies are mostly going to these smaller oil companies, and it is very expensive to be doing drilling and exploration. And so I'm not against the oil industries. I think we should go ahead and develop our energy independence in that sense. We've got Canadians now that are going to be shipping oil to China. China is just sucking up all the commodities and energy in the world. Have anybody ever been there? I mean, they're like, we're 400 million people. They got two countries there that each one of them are three times as large as us. And that's just two. I mean, we've got to get smart. We shouldn't be picking winners and losers in energy. We should let the free market go. We should let the real basic research, by the way, does not go on in the government. I heard Barack Obama say the other day, all this research we have to invest in. No, we have some role, but let private industry and private academia do that research to advance us. And so, in short, I would want us to be a stronger oil producer. I would not try to race. I would be concerned about the environment. I'm very concerned about the drought. I don't care what caused it. I think we've got to build up our water infrastructure. We've got, and there's a lot of things we can do. In agriculture, we should have more of a market system as well, so that we're building instead of just pretending we're balancing accounts. I talked to, and I know this is, the agriculture is a little bit away from the oil, but it's basically about how government should approach this. And in agriculture, we've got insurance programs for water rather than building up water infrastructure.
Thank you, Ben.
Well, you know, one of the things that I'm glad that the president moved forward on is on public lands. These large oil companies would come in and buy up all the leases and they'd sit on them in part to speculate and drive up price. So on taxpayers' land now, it's either use it or lose it. If you're not going to drill on it, if you're not going to explore on it, if you're not going to work on it, then you're not going to keep that lease. We're going to give it to someone who will look for oil and do what needs to be done to recover that. So that's a good thing that the administration did. Fossil fuels, they're going to be with us for a long time. But I don't think we need to be bailing out oil companies and this brochure that I mentioned before, Taxpayers for Common Sense. I could read tax cut, tax break, tax perk, whatever you want to call it, one after another for oil companies on here. They're doing just fine. We should be taking some of those dollars that we recover from that. We should be putting it into clean energy. We should be putting it into solar. We should be putting it into wind. We should be putting it into district energy in St. Paul, which does, you know, fabulous work, and our businesses love it there because it's reliable, inexpensive energy to heat and cool the buildings downtown St. Paul, which makes St. Paul aware when many people are looking at moving there and setting up a business. We need to look better at conservation. We could put a lot of people to work repairing our schools, and we would save a lot of taxpayers a lot of money in energy costs. In West St. Paul, they moved ahead and they did this, and within a couple of years, they saw that they had gotten their investment back, and they were making end runs for taxpayers not to have to pay as much for energy costs. So there's a lot we can do, and we should be doing it, but we can't put everything onto the fossil fuels, especially subsidizing when they're doing so well, so handsomely with their profits.
Thank you, Tony.
Mm-hmm. What can Congress do to increase oil production? Was that the question?
To encourage that you could become number one in that area.
Mm-hmm. We need to look at a wide variety of options. I do agree with Representative McCollum. I do believe we need to end subsidies to oil companies. I also believe we need to end subsidies to green energy companies as well, and allow for the private marketplace to determine specific locations, what is best in terms of what the local market is demanding, and allow the states to regulate the energy production within their own borders. If we can have the states competing in various forms of drilling, wind energy, solar, and allowing the market forces to determine which ones are most successful and which ones are going to be failures, we as the taxpayers and energy consumers in America will be much better off. Solyndra is a great epic example of why we don't want the federal government in the energy business and green energy or oil or whatever, picking winners and losers. A lot of times what we hear out of Washington, D.C. and local politics even are these warm ideas, these fuzzy ideas that may sound really good, like alternative energy or green energy, when in paper, they may look good, and in your heart they may look good, but then in reality, there is no function to the actual business. I believe the taxpayers lost $500 million, is that right, remember, on Solyndra. Solyndra turned out to be an epic failure, turned out to have a failing business model. We used our money, our hardworking money, to borrow and back a $500 million loan to Solyndra. So what should the federal government do in terms of state by state? Get out of the way. Let the states determine their own destiny. Let the local governments do it. A great example is our neighbor to the west, North Dakota. Fracking has boomed their economy. They have one of the lowest unemployment rates in the entire nation, and their economy is prospering, and all the people that are living in North Dakota are prospering, and there are jobs galore there. So competing models within the states, I believe, is the most responsible way to move forward in terms of energy production.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Betty. What level of control should the federal government have in how school districts operate, including how much funding should they contribute?
Well, the federal government should have a very limited role in education. One place I think the federal government should live up to its responsibility, it was the right thing to do, was to pass what's now called IDEA, which gave all students, all of our students, what you would call, when I was going to school, the special ed students, an opportunity to achieve their potential. The federal government made a promise to school districts, made a promise to parents as to how many dollars that they were going to put in to pay for the extra teachers, the cost, some of the infrastructure that needed to happen in those buildings, and the federal government has fallen down on the job. So we're paying on property taxes money that the federal government should be putting into special education. It's the right thing to do to make sure all of our children succeed. The other thing that we need to be looking at is working with governors, and the National Governors Association has been working together to come up with standards that are driven by the states that are universal throughout the United States, so that, and we live in a very mobile society right now, so that if a parent is transferred from one state to another and their child is in second grade, first grade, by the time that child gets to third grade, that they can read at a third grade level, that they're doing math at the appropriate level, so if that parent receives another job opportunity in another state, that child doesn't fall behind. So the federal government, working with the governors, working with partnership, but Leave No Child Behind was a huge mistake. I voted against it. I knew it was going to cost our districts money, and it didn't really improve the quality of life of our children. We have too many children in this country who are falling behind. The best way to get them moving ahead is working with local teachers, working with their parents, working with their districts, and identifying the needs of that student, not having national testing companies making money and then telling a child a year later that they didn't do as well as they could have. We need to intervene and work with that child now, and the best people to do it is the community here locally. Thank you, Tony.
Sure, I believe that the federal government's role, or the role of Congress in terms of education, is to be an absolute strong partner with local units of government, state government, school board districts, and also the actual schools. I happen to agree with President Obama's initiative, certain aspects of it, the race to the top. I believe that it's heading in the right direction, and I agree with the part in terms of it's giving more local control to the school boards, to the districts, and to the state government. That's the way that we need to move forward. Right here in Minnesota, we have an enormous achievement gap. Minorities are graduating at lower rates than their counterparts. We need to address this situation. This is a very real situation that has consequences for our future. If you talk to a lot of the parents in the minority districts in St. Paul, Minneapolis, and other areas, you'll find a continuing theme is choice. Parents want choice in terms of the kind and type of education that your children, your students, are going to be able to have. And that means we need choices with charter schools, public schools, private schools, and also for homeschool, which is a very viable option right here in our 4th Congressional District. So encouraging competition, once again, same as on the state level, allowing different states to compete and allowing the local units to have more control and more say in terms of how they're going to administer their education, I believe is absolutely vital for closing the achievement gap, offering parents more choice in terms of the kind of education that their student and their particular children will receive. And so those are my thoughts in terms of how to strengthen education right here in Minnesota.
Thank you.
Well, I would say that if elected, I would not work for the NEA, and that's not putting down the NEA, but we need independence from the NEA. Now, also, with respect to what Tony said, localizing control does not mean going to the district and the state government. What about the private sector? And he mentioned the private sector, but that is localized control. Now, here's one thing we can do that I have advocated ever since I learned about it. in Arizona, they give a tax credit for a school tuition organization, and that provides a scholarship for low-income children or students to go to a private school. And I think this is great. I have to tell you, I went to a public school, and then I got a scholarship to Minnehaha Academy, which was at that time, and I'm sure still is, a very fine private school. And I am so grateful for that. I often wonder, how did this happen to me? It's a different world. Now, Betty herself has gone to the University of St. Catherine. I went to the University of Minnesota. I also audited at the St. Thomas. I can see a world of difference. So we've got to come at this totally differently. What about the model of K through 12? Is that what we want, or do we want lifelong learning? What can you do with the internet? There are so many great opportunities for you to go out today and learn on the internet. You can study at Stanford, you can study at MIT. These are things I know that St. Paul Public Schools is starting to work with this. This is what we've got to do. And we can provide more jobs for teachers if we have choice. Private schools will provide opportunities for teachers. Now, somebody from the St. Paul School District, I talked to her at a health club, and she told me that, well, that will never match the lifestyle that the teachers want. And I'm not saying they're rich. I'm not. But I think they can be richer if we can be more successful in education. You know, why don't we have year-round school? This is what successful countries do. People who really want to learn, they don't want to stop learning. Can you imagine when you're a child and all you have to do is learn and take care of yourself and get along with your family? What a great time of your life. So why not give kids the opportunity to do that? I work with the refugees from Southeast Asia. On the weekends, their kids, they study science and mathematics in their own language. They study the Chinese culture, and Jewish schools have done the same. Successful.
Thank you. So many more questions and topics, but simply out of time. We'll begin closing statements with Steve.
Okay. Well, I really enjoyed this debate. I really have enjoyed all the debates. This actually is the most enjoyable debate because it's very laid back and flexible, and we're not talking, you know, into the radio or at a TV screen or having a legal women voters tell us exactly what we have to do. I like them too, but this is the greatest one. You have a chance to send an independent representative with insight and compassion to Washington. Now, my idea of shifting the power and the resources back to the state has been embraced by Mitt Romney himself. Now, this is a district. I got a chance to talk to someone in a co-op who said that she was thrilled that they were going to be able to get Betty McCollum instead of Michelle Bachmann. So I guess this is the kind of Bachmann versus McCollum era here, in her eyes. However, it's a time of flux. It's a time of flux in the United States, and it's a time that we need independent thinking. Now, I can really do the job. I can talk to all of those senators and representatives and people in the White House, probably even lawyers, about the judiciary. And I can focus their attention on the fiscal cliff that we're on, focus their attention on the competition that we face with other countries, focus their attention on the role, the niche that we want for ourselves. We're not going to go back to the way it was. And so we've got to be very energetic and very disciplined and very imaginative and work together in order to find that niche that we all want. China's passed, it may pass us, Japan is competition, and we want to win this race.
Thank you. Tony.
When Representative McCollum was sworn into Congress in 2001, the unemployment rate was 4.1%, the national debt was $5.7 trillion. I've offered throughout my campaign many ideas and many solutions in terms of reducing our deficit in a responsible way that will not hurt Medicare, Social Security, and will not hurt our poorest members of America. I do want to stress that the national debt is our number one security threat to our standard of living and to our future as Americans. If we cannot come together at this point in time in history to find ways to tackle
this enormous problem, we are all going to suffer as a result, and we are going to hand over to our children an America with less freedom and less career opportunities. These are the stakes that are at place right now. I've done a lot of campaigning throughout Congressional District 4. I've had the honor of meeting tens of thousands of people, and one message is clear from the people of the 4th District. People are tired of the extreme partisanship in Washington, D.C., and the United States Congress is failing Minnesota families on jobs and the economy. Now, one last, it never came up with the debate, but one last area of Representative McCollum's partisanship was the issue of the Stillwater Bridge. Now, if you remember the building of the bridge, all our entire Minnesota leadership, Governor Dayton, Senator Amy Klobuchar, Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann, everybody came together to allow this bridge to be built for the people, and Representative McCollum was the one person who was against the building of the bridge. So I just wanted to bring that to light. And finally, I am asking for your support and your vote on November 6th. I'd be honored to represent you and serve you in the United States Congress. Thank you.
Thank you, and Betty.
Well, I'll tackle the bridge first. I was always for a bridge. I just thought we could build one bridge and then work towards repairing the thousands of other bridges that are deficient in this state. All of you drive on more than one bridge. So I was looking for a solution that replaced the bridge but allowed us to move forward in making sure that other families, all of us, drove on safe bridges in the 4th District. Now it's time to move forward. So I want to thank you for coming. I want to thank you for listening. I want to thank you for hosting this. This election is about whether we move forward together or whether we go back to the failed policies that got us into this horrific place we find ourselves in with our economy. I want a strong, vibrant middle class. I want my children to have a strong, vibrant middle class in their future. That's the promise of America. So I'm committed to the hope and opportunity that America can provide. But I want the seniors to know that have worked so hard to give me the opportunities that I've enjoyed in my life. In fact, an opportunity as just an average person to serve in the greatest Congress in the world, that I will fight hard to protect your Social Security and your Medicare, and for your grandchildren to have a first-class education and continuing workforce development so they can compete in the 21st century. You heard that I care passionately about making sure that we have good infrastructure. But in this election, there's something else that's really at stake here in Minnesota, and that's our rights. So you need to know that I'm going to work to protect our most basic rights, our civil rights, our human rights, our workers' rights, women's rights, and voters' rights. They're all at stake. You can count on me to give you my very best every day I show up for work. I would really appreciate an opportunity to serve once again in Congress. Thank you.
Thank you. And replays of this live broadcast will be on Channel 16. There'll be a write-up of this forum in the Stillwater Gazette tomorrow, Thursday, October 25th, for those who are watching replays. And I'll email the three of you a copy once it's posted. Thank you so much for participating. Thank you all for joining us.